Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming.
Today, we're going to have a discussion from our panelists about online flipped and or blended learning. So we're going to cover three really big topics that probably could each be their own session. Our panel today is Laura Harrison. They're going to introduce themselves much better, but this is Laura Harrison, Professor Jim Wallace, Professor Scott Ramsey, and Laura's going to set the stage from the university's perspective, and then we're going to hear about the practical experiences from two of our, what's the word, experimental, anyway. So we're going to get started just by talking about what is a flipped classroom, what is blended learning, what is online learning. So Laura, you get the first question, lucky you. And your question is, describe the landscape of online flipped and blending learning at U of T, and how and why are these becoming such big topics, and how are they growing, and how, what are the next things that are coming along?
Sure. So I'm speaking from a perspective of the university coast to coast. I'm the director of online learning strategies, and I work on all three campuses and in all divisions and all programs. So I'm going to share with you some of my insights of what I'm observing and what's going on. We were asked to describe the landscape, so I went with the landscape theme here just to explain what's happening there. I wanted to mention briefly that there's actually a lot going on in the province that's a factor, and it's certainly influencing thinking at the university about how we want to engage with our learners. I put up a URL here, ecampusontario.ca. If you haven't seen this before, you might want to have a look at it at some point. It's a new provincial initiative where they are sharing out information about online courses that are available to all students in the province. It's a giant portal that helps students discover what's available across all the Ontario universities and colleges. And U of T has right now 9 courses that are listed in this portal that were funded by the province. And that certainly had an impact on us in terms of getting resources to develop really high quality, good online courses. And they're continuing to expand, looking at student services and faculty development supports and so on for the province. So there's certainly an environment of rising interest and commitment of resources from the province here. In terms of how that's playing out at U of T, we have a number of options, a number of modalities that we see, and we're not prescriptive. We don't say, we should do this, we should do that. We suggest to instructors that there are all these possibilities and that they need to assess what's right for them, what's right for their students, what's right for their subject area. So on the screen, you can see I have this bit of a continuum, and I want to focus on the three on your right first. Those are our core modalities. We have fully online courses, which of course is 100% online. You never have to come to class except perhaps for a final exam, by definition, at U of T, and we actually track that in ROSI. If something's an online course, it's noted as such, and we have particular supports around that. In the middle, we have hybrid courses, which sounds like some kind of echo car, but it's actually, hybrid course is a term that's used for a course that's half online and half in the classroom. So we have some reduction of class time, moving some of that into an online sphere. It's also, historically that was also called blended, but blended's become a bit of a fuzzier word these days. And then finally, inverted or flipped classroom, which you probably heard about, where the presentation of the content or preparatory stage is offered to the students online. They can prepare at home before they come to class, and then in class they do what might have formerly been their homework assignments or activities they would have done individually, they're now doing in the classroom or as a group, so changing the class experience. So we have those three, which I've tried to define, and then just to put a cap on that, the word blended, if you hear that, refers to hybrid, partly online, partly in class, but it also kind of blurs its way over into flipped. Some people refer to flipped classrooms as blended as well. Basically, blended meaning a mix of technology and in-class, which isn't very specific, it's an umbrella term. And then way over here, we have MOOCs, which are a form of fully online course, but I put them in a separate circle because they're not degree courses at U of T. They're outreach, open learning for learners beyond our boundaries. But of course, the materials from MOOCs can also be used in these other contexts. So we have the possibility of reusing that content, and that is one of the strategies that we're using at U of T. So when we think about our choices, from my perspective, thinking institutionally, some of the kinds of strategic alignments that we can come to support programs, academic programs, are thinking about student mobility, if they want to move between programs or between courses or between institutions. If there's bottleneck courses where there's too many students and not enough space, if they want to take summer courses to get a head start or to catch up. Open education, if we have outreach, if we want to share our materials broadly. Graduate professional programs are on the rise. Recruitment into graduate programs. And also our provincial profile. How do we fit in with the other engineering programs, for example, across the province? So those are just some of the things that we think about when we're making choices. And we come up with things like, that's an example of one of our online courses that was funded by the province, but meets a number of these other types of goals. Come on. But not only thinking about program needs, we also think about our learner preferences. And we've been surveying students for a few years in new online courses, and this is some data that I just wanted to share. When we asked students to identify what are their motivators for taking online courses, flexibility in scheduling is number one. Those are the tall bars in the middle. Also, remote access, not having to come to campus. For some, it's their preferred learning environments, and for some, they were just after the course content. In terms of our capacity, what we're doing through my portfolio is we have a lot of faculty development initiatives. We have workshops and programs to help people redesign their courses. We'll do consultation with departments and programs. I've been invited to meet with small groups around whatever new initiatives they have on the go in curriculum development. We help with developing proposals for getting funding, and also community outreach, facilitating whatever events such as this, helping out with community outreach. And that URL is for more information about my portfolio.
We'll send out the PowerPoints to everyone, of course.
And then finally, just to look by the numbers, just to give you a sense of what's going on. Right now, we have approximately 35 undergraduate online courses, 60 plus graduate, depending on the term they come and go. We have 13 ministry-funded online courses, four more coming online this year. We have 14 ministry-funded modules projects, which are quite intense content development projects. And I would say we have hundreds of hybrid and flipped across the university. If you did a count how many people are working in this domain, the numbers would be high. And then finally, there's some funding programs through the province, through the provost, through the ITIF fund. I'm not going to go into the details here, but if there's time questions later, we can talk about that. And also, our MOOC projects also receive some funding.
Thank you.
In a nutshell, how was that?
It was really good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. This is why. Clearly. Okay. Yeah, let's hold questions till the end. We'll get an overview from everyone. It might help hearing some of the different perspectives before we go into questions, but we do have a nice chunk of time today, so we should have quite a bit of time to ask and have questions answered towards the end of the session. Yes, we can switch to Jim, actually. It's printed on the sheet, so I had the wrong order. So Scott, you didn't have. Scott is the only one that doesn't have a PowerPoint presentation, so just saying. Is it okay like that? Yeah, I think it's okay. Did you want me to pull up? Did you want me to pull up a website or like YouTube or anything? I can do that on the fly.
Jim, you're gonna go now, or do you want me to go right now?
Oh, well, you know.
Yeah, I mean, I just had a few things I was gonna talk about, and then.
Well, I have a question for you.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So, Scott, can you tell us about your experience with online flipped? And apparently, we have blended in our title. Maybe it should have been hybrid. In general terms, what were your key challenges and accomplishments? Can you tell us a little bit about the variation of projects you've done? I mean, you've been doing this for a few years, and your projects have certainly changed in scope and scale over the last few years. Give us an overview of what you've been working on and what's coming up.
Yeah, sure, absolutely, thanks. So, hello everyone. Probably around 8 years ago or something, I think maybe maybe more. We started filming all my first year lectures.
Oh wait, maybe you should tell us who you are.
Oh yeah, sorry, I'm Scott Ramsey. I'm teaching stream faculty in materials engineering. I started filming my first year lectures and just posting them, and students responded pretty well, and the uptake was reasonable, you know, 40, 50 sort of hits most of the time. You hear me okay? Yeah? All right. And then there was some funding from the dean's office in engineering to do some variety of these reusable learning objects. So some of them were digital and some other ones, but particularly the digital ones you're interested in for this talk.
Scott, can you define what a reusable learning object is?
A reusable learning object, I mean, it's a, I guess, fairly broad term. Specifically, the digital ones would just be little, anything from a little video that students could use to, I suppose, even, I mean, Laura could probably answer it better than I can. Online.
I think like one of the keys to think about is that when you're investing time in developing digital objects, you're thinking about, is it something that students are going to consume once, or is it something that you're going to have as part of your course library for the next 4 or 5 years? And what factors into that would be, you know, how professional it is, how much time you spend on it, how much money you spend on it. And so, of course, something that's kind of on the fly, maybe that's your webcam video, but something that Scott's planning on using for the next 5 years, that's when we get into production and post-production editing and things like that. So it's just a thing to think about.
Sure, yeah. Can everyone hear me, by the way? Towards the back, I don't have the room mic on, so yeah, everyone's nodding?
Yeah.
Fantastic. Thanks, Jason. the lecture capture has up until now always just been intended to be used that term for the students enrolled in that course, and it's been, I think, successful for that purpose. So then, for this engineering instructional innovation program through the dean's office, I worked with a graphic artist. We made a few, you know, nice little slides and things like that. It was a lot of work and it cost quite a bit, and I don't think that was something that I'll do again. Maybe I will eventually, but it has to be for the right decision, for the right reason. I tried some green screen work as well. I've got a green screen in my office, so you can, you know, substitute in like a crisp white background or whatever else you want. And I think, again, there's a place for that. We could talk about that later if you like, but that's not something I'm currently doing anymore. Then I had the pleasure to work with Lori on this Allure project. So we had some funding there to continue developing these reusable learning objects. So I continued to build a series of these short little tablet capture, like Khan style video, if anyone's familiar with Khan Academy. So short, you know, 10 minute roughly little videos to continue to support my course. We did a study on introducing those in a particular portion of the course, and I presented that to ASEE, the American Society for Engineering Education. Then there was some funding from the Ontario Online, from the ministry, and I had a chance to build an entire online course, so this new course. And so I did that. I did all the content as captures on my tablet, and then we built them into this Articulate Storyline package. It's this software package. You can build a nice, slick, interactive thing. We had a great summer student last summer work on that. She knew the technical content. She also had really good skills in graphic artist art. After having done the course and sort of seeing the students interact with it, I don't think that it's something that I want to again continue with. It was a lot of work, and I don't think it was really the right format for, at least for my engineering course.
Can you say a little bit more about why you didn't think it was?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I don't want to go for too long, but yeah, I think that the students perceived it, and maybe it was the way we built it, but I think they perceived it as a little Mickey Mouse. It's kind of, I think it's mainly, or a lot of its intention is for corporate training. You know, you can do a compliance training program in a bank or something, and you click through and you can see the little customer walk in or things like that. And I think it's engaging that way, but my sense at least is the engineering students that come in, they want to see what the content is, what they're going to be assessed on, do the assessment, and get on with their other courses. And I think at least the way we built the module, it was too many clicks. too much time waiting for something to advance, and they would rather just see a sequence of videos, probably with some little quizzes. So that was, you know, my perception of it. And we had a little focus group. It was only one student, but you know, that was the feedback we got from him. And anecdotally as well, just, you know, talking around with other students in the department, and showing them what we built, that was the feeling. So then it was actually interesting, last semester, a couple things. So I had now all the content for the course essentially built as short little 6 to 10 minute videos, which was one of the outcomes of that Ontario Online initiative. And that matched probably about 80 to 90% of the content of the course I was teaching on campus in person. And so students had access to that kind of as a, I don't know if that makes it blended. You know, I encouraged them to watch it beforehand. I don't think that they did, but they had access to it at least. If there was one particular topic that they were curious about that, or they didn't quite get, they could watch that. I also captured my own videos and posted those to my YouTube channel. And it was really interesting. Last semester, you know, on each lecture video, I had about 250 hits, and those were unlisted, so it's only students in the class. And there's about 250 students enrolled in the class. Now, they could get a couple of hits if they log in from a different device, I think. But it should be close to that number of unique views. So it's really interesting, the uptake. And I for the first time, because I was particularly aware of it, and I was very open with students, I said, look, I don't judge you if you want to stay home and watch my videos at home. You know, that's great, as long as you're successful. And I had a handful of students, it's anecdotal, but they'd come into my office for office hours, and they'd self-report that, hey, I'm one of those home, you know, I watch your stuff at home, that's all I do, I don't come to class. And they're honest about it, and I think because I told them, look, I don't judge you for it, that's great, they were open about it. It was really, really interesting for me. And, you know, based on the questions that they were asking, I could tell, hey, they were pretty smart, they're doing well. And I mean, the class average was good. It's not a formal study, but it was very interesting to see students using it that way. So I don't know if that makes it kind of, having students elect to just stay home and watch the videos, is that blended, hybrid, semi-online? I don't know, or elective online? I don't know. It was great, but it was quite interesting, just being aware of it. One thing that I've wanted to do, I'm working on now, is in the fall, I've got this brand new course that I developed. It's the in-person version of the online course I was telling you about. And I really want to put together a good quality set of lecture videos that can be reused for a few years to come. And I think that there's a need for a bit of added production value in that. So I've got a graduate student who's helping out with that. Matt's been fantastic. We're doing a dress rehearsal this summer with my summer course. So we got 5 cameras in there, we got a master shot at the back, I've got a GoPro that I have capturing demos, lecture demos I do. I'm trying to pull out all the stops, every demo I've ever done, you know, basically every lecture I'm doing something engaging up there. We've got a GoPro up on the wall there. If you've ever seen some of the MIT OpenCourseWare stuff, there's often just a few shots showing you're in the class. And I think that, I mean, MIT, it certainly benefits because one of the reasons I think people watch them is they think, hey, I want to know what an MIT class is like. But I mean, you know, we're U of T, we're a top-notch institute as well, and I think people will go to see some of these things because they want to get a sense, hey, what happens there? And so I think just having a few shots that say, hey, this is a lecture, and we're not hiding it. I mean, I know the best practice in online resources is often, oh, don't just do a lecture capture. And I think there's some truth to that. I mean, I've seen some horrible things even coming out of MIT. There's one where the prof obviously didn't want to do it, but they said, look, we will support you, we'll capture it, and then they cut his lecture into 7-minute chunks. It was awful. I think that lecture capture can be really, really good. I mean, we'll see how this ends up, but I think first of all, you should be clear about, we're not trying to hide it, that's what we're doing. So it's going to be a 50-minute video of the lecture, but I think the added production value will really help. So then we've got a tracking camera, we've got this swivel thing that tracks me as I go, just to add a bit of interest. And then Matt is operating another camera, so we can zoom in on parts of the board, and then we'll cut to, so I did some of the initial post-production myself, and Matt's doing a bit of that. We're gonna have to work out the timing on that. But it's quite a bit of work in post-production, but I think it'll pay off. And then the other thing I'm working on is a MOOC that'll go on to Coursera, and that's gonna be for a much more general, sort of general public audience. And that should be available soon, very soon, by the end of the summer, yeah.
Thank you, Scott. I thought you brought up a bunch of really interesting ideas in that. Like, some of the things that I pulled out were the idea that one size doesn't fit all, not in terms of learning, in terms of how you produce this stuff. Like, videos and modules and audience change, like, it's so different, not only at engineering versus the rest of the university, but from class to class, from year to year, from whether it's a mediation class or a professional class. There's so many different things to think about when you're deciding how to do your content. And then I like the fact that you've coined a new term for online pedagogy literature, I mean, like autonomous learning, half, you know, blended online. Like, that'll be your contribution. Elective online. And then the other thing that I thought you brought up that was really interesting was this idea of the changing climate. When I started in engineering and we were doing lecture capture, I wanted to put some of the lecture videos on YouTube, and it was a blanket no, right? For a lot of the things that you were discussing. This year for lecture capture, I asked all of the instructors. All of the instructors said it was absolutely fine, and we had zero problems with playback. We got the most hits that we've ever had. It just seemed like a very positive change. I mean, the students are very familiar with YouTube, and that's in 3.5 years. So where will it be in another 3 years? I don't know. Jim, I'm going to ask you the same question. I'm going to throw some stuff up, I'll throw your brilliant work up on the screen, and I'll let you run with it. Maybe you can give your introduction while I pull this up. You could, yeah.
And you can see yourself.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I forgot, Laura. You did that blind. That's extra points. All right, sorry. Here we go. So if you want a reminder on the question, we're just talking about your experience, some of the things that you learned, your aha moments, your challenges, anything that you'd like to share.
Okay, so I organized this. First of all, introducing myself, I'm a professor of mechanical and industrial engineering. And why am I here? I've taught two versions of online course. One is an elective course for senior undergraduates and graduate students, a 500 series course on alternative energy systems. That course has been online since fall 2011. This past fall was the fifth online session, and we had 235 students. And I also offered in the fall of 2014 a MOOC on Coursera, Wind, Waves, and Tides, which was a subset of MIE 515. And I have to say, it was a wonderful learning experience, although a brutal one. And so the first three sessions of my 515 online, we just did lecture capture, and I'd like to echo what Scott said. It doesn't work online. You standing there talking for an hour is not a suitable way to transpose the thing to the online forum. And so Wind, Waves, and Tides enabled me to experiment with delivery in shorter, sharper chunks and stuff, and that worked really well. So the course was entirely revised after the MOOC, and the last two sessions of the alternative energy systems have essentially followed the MOOC format and have been quite successful. So I think that's working nicely. Now I hope to be able to offer Wind, Waves, and Tides again soon in online mode, on-demand mode, just assuming the faculty supports that. So.
Do you want to say that, maybe talk about the difference between on-demand and
Sure. Okay. Yeah. So the first version of the MOOC was taught as a 7-week non-credit course. It started in, I don't know, beginning of October and finished in the beginning of December, and that was it. Okay. Now then, it played in archive mode for many, many, many months until Coursera changed their format. But now they're going to this on-demand system where essentially you pick some interval and people sign up for the course and say after 2 weeks or something, they start a new cohort so that all the people that signed up in that particular time period then are the cohort that go through for that session. And that's important because I had some peer assessed assignments and some other things. You actually need a cohort of students. You can't just take the course just arbitrarily. Is that a fair summary?
Continuous intake. Yeah. That's rolling cohorts.
Yeah, so the course would just keep looping, and that would be, I think, a good thing. Okay, so Allison said challenges and whatever. So a couple of things to note. Production quality is a challenge. The first time, my board writing is pretty bad, actually. And so we had to make some high quality stuff for the MOOC, and that's what we continue to try to do for the online course. But these students, current students, are raised on the internet, and they have very high expectations about what you're going to deliver online. And they'll tell you if it doesn't meet their expectations. They are not shy.
Do you have an example? Was there something that you thought the students would like, but they called you out, or was it more in general?
Just more in general. Like if you, I tend to like really simple diagrams, right? So I'll just make some nice simple sketch or something, and they like something more finished, right? And so they'll just say, these look like amateurs.
Well, I joke that TED Talks ruined us because everybody has this, standard for TED Talks, like the stage and the beautiful background and the multiple cam. It's expensive.
Yeah, you can't do that.
No.
So a couple of things is that your graphics have to be decent. And the other thing which is really important and relatively easy to fix is the sound. I invested in a high quality microphone and that's paid off dividends. The students are very happy with the sound. So the second challenge, so we can talk about any of these things in the question period, but the second challenge is the exceptional level of organization required. You put the course online and the students have to know what to do, and you just take it for granted when you appear in the classroom, you tell the students, oh yeah, for next lecture do this and do that or whatever, and all that has to take place in the online forum without you. So you really have to think through the course. So. You have to have the whole thing laid out in absolute complete detail at the beginning of the course. It's just they need to know exactly when they're supposed to do what and how to do it and everything. The other thing is I'm of the generation where all these online things are challenging, but I assume that the students can do anything, and they can. So you actually have to teach them, you have to tell them what you expect to how to do the online learning. So even dumb things like instructions for online assignment submissions. How do you do that? And if your TAs don't want to have a nightmare, you've got to give them a file naming convention and stuff like that. Really detailed stuff so that when they submit the files, the TAs can manage them easily. All my course assignments are done online. So okay, so that's a challenge. The other challenge, and I haven't solved this yet, is communications. Students want access to teaching staff. They prefer a live lecture to online. I've taught the same cohort this year in 515 online and another course, MIE 411, in live lecture. And so I had many of the same students in both classes, and they overwhelmingly prefer me live than online. So that may be a problem with my online delivery, but generally they want you. So I tried running the 515 online entirely. The students really want to have access to you, so I went back to a live tutorial this year. There's a small cohort that actually come to that, but it's a psychological thing. They really want to know that they can find you, even though a few people actually use that. In terms of communications, I use Piazza. Piazza works fantastically. Allison put me onto that, but it works really well. The students like it. There are some issues with privacy I think the university has, and so I gave the students the usual warning, and I had a backup discussion board on Blackboard for people who didn't want to use Piazza. Nobody ever used that. But the interesting thing is that there are quite a number of students unaccounted for. You know how many people signed up for Piazza, and you know how many people are enrolled in your class, and there's a big gap, and so those people were unserved. I have no idea what they did, basically. They didn't come to see me. I know the people that came to tutorial, I got to know, and they were active on Piazza too. So there's a cohort of people that just don't do anything. How do you reach those students? I have no idea. Okay, so accomplishments. Well, this will sound really strange, but I learned a lot about teaching. This has been a great experiment. So I'm a generation where we had absolutely zero training in teaching. You show up at the university and they say, oh, your class is X. Okay, go to it. And so fortunately now the university has started to rectify that situation. Susan McCann's put on a great course for PhD students to learn how to deliver lectures and so forth. This has taught me a lot about what works and what doesn't work, and I'm trying to apply the lessons to my other courses. So organization is really important, and the students really like the organization. I just, if I can blow my own horn a little bit, that one of the things from the course evaluations that just came out, hands down the most organized course I've taken in my time at U of T. So they really like that. The other thing I learned about attention is about attention span. I'm slowly learning. I was always of the more is better school, right? So I want to give value to the students and deliver as much as I can. And so the worst level of that was one time I was teaching heat mass transfer and felt it necessary to derive the Gaussian flat plate solution in its entire gory detail. And poor Susan McCann taught the same cohort the next hour. And it took her a half hour to calm the class down. So there's a limit to what they'll receive. And so I'm learning that very nicely with those online modules. You pick a chunk, and as Scott was saying about the MIT, you can't just chop up a live lecture into 7-minute increments. But when you're working on online delivery, sort of 10 minutes is probably about the best increment that you can tried to break things into discrete 10-minute increments. The other thing which I've learned a lot about in online is formative assessment, which I never paid much attention to. But the students really like this, actually. And so I have in my lectures built-in quizzes. Allison's been fantastic in helping to sort that out. The students, one of the other things that it does is because you can track the
I'm assuming most of, but just to break it down, our introductory panel, so.
So yeah, I'm old school test, right? And so formative assessment is some assignment or questions or something that you give to the students and they aren't marked, right? And so in the videos, there's some built-in quizzes and the students get multiple attempts at the quizzes, and if they get the wrong answer, a little thing flashes up and tells them what they did wrong. It takes a lot of time to put these together. But the students love this stuff, and there's no marks for that. They just complete it, and they essentially, when they complete it, you know that they've actually done the work. And so the students appreciate it, not only because they learn from it, but also because the fact that they're required to complete the quiz pushes them to do it. They love the flexibility to take the lectures whenever they want, but basically within, say, a week's time or something like that, but then it keeps them so they don't get 3 weeks behind by having this kind of stuff. And so I've been applying this to other courses. The other thing I did for the online courses is to make practice problems and their posted solutions as well, and they love those because it just helps them. They're actually recycled exam questions that I can't use again, and so they really love that. I'm doing that in other courses. And I made use of peer-assessed assignments in the MOOC, because you don't have any teaching assistants, really. And so I've now used that in my regular course. For a variety of reasons, you can't actually use the peer assessments, so you have to hire a teaching assistant to actually do the marking. It's a way of giving the students some kind of independent assignment to work on. The quality of feedback that the students give isn't always that great, and I have to think of how I can rectify that. But it's an interesting experiment that you can do online that you really would have a hard time doing without the online technology. The students submit their assignments online. The software randomly assigns three classmates, or however many you designate, to mark and comment on the essay. It goes back to the student, and they have to mark three other essays, so it gives them some practice in assessing, and also gets, as several students said, it gives you perspectives of how other students are seeing the material, and so that also is something that's useful. So I've been applying these to my other courses as well. So let me just sort of end the introductory comments by citing something else from the teaching evaluation. I thought this was a very perceptive comment. Other courses do not need to be online, but could definitely learn a lot from the way in which this course was delivered and from the supplementary resources available to enhance learning. So I think the kind of modules that you develop for online learning are useful in any course, basically. And so if I had to offer anybody advice, I'd say, I wouldn't necessarily say go online entirely, but you could certainly take a portion of your course and experiment with it, and I think the students would welcome that kind of activity.
Thank you. I mean, you can see that there's a reason why we asked Jim and Scott and Laurie to speak, because they bring up so many of the extremely common challenges and benefits that we see with online learning. I think you brought up, Jim, a few things that you said that where you're talking about like key things to invest in, like that balance of like how much time you spend on production versus what your objectives are for the course and what's best for your students. When it comes to hardware or buying a microphone, that seems like such an obvious thing, but audio is one of, Will always likes to joke, audio is like the key thing that students will, I know it sets a mood. So you spend $100 on a microphone and then all of a sudden your students can watch a whole video without, we've all seen the bad YouTube videos. Of course. Yeah.
About the sound. So I always speak really slowly because not everybody has perfect language skills in our student cohort. And in fact, in the regular lecture class, people like that. But the students get frustrated on YouTube and say, these lectures are too slow. Of course, you can speed them up. And the students regularly watch me at 1.5 or 2 times the speed on YouTube. But it's interesting because some of them don't realize you can do that. And so next year, I'm actually going to post a note and say, look, I recorded them slowly for people so people can understand me. But if you can easily understand me, then speed it up, right? Because it's really interesting. The course evaluations are so helpful. If you ask the students for constructive comments, I got back 5 pages of comments from the students about what to do and what not to do.
It's almost 11. We got started a little bit later than I was hoping for today. So I have more questions that I've written out or that we've written out, but I think that it might be a good time to poll the audience before we get too far ahead and run out of time for questions. So is there anything that's... first hand was at the back.
Yeah. Yeah, actually I have 2 questions. I was quite curious to see if you look at the people that in your class that were using Piazza and those that were not participating, if at the end those that were participating did better or was sort of independent on the final evaluation.
Yeah, I intend to do that. That's on my summer to-do list, but that's a great question. My gut feeling would be that there would be a big difference, actually. I mean, one of the things that online teaching provides you with data that you don't normally have for your regular classes. And so I taught the online course in the fall, and then I taught a live class in the winter term. And it made me realize that there's always a cohort that's not engaged. So there were roughly 20, or I had a class of 160 in the winter, and there were roughly 30 people that never came, right? And they never come to see you or anything. So that cohort that's not engaged is always there. It's just that...
They're more visible.
They're
more visibly not there.
They're more visibly not there. But indeed, the people that didn't come to class are the ones that are failing, essentially. And so, yeah.
And I have a very quick question. Very interesting, the peer assessed assignments. What software do you use, and actually, do you provide them a solution to peer assess, or you let them work out the solution before assessing their peers?
Right. Okay. So the software I use is called Peer Scholar. It was actually developed at UTM.
UTSC.
Oh, UTSC, sorry, yeah. And so...
And it's available institutionally. It's through the portal, through Blackboard. It's a integrated tool.
So what the I use Peer Scholar for non-technical questions. So this is a course on alternative energy, and so I asked them to write an essay about, say, the NIMBY problem or something like that, right? And or, you know, how will rooftop solar energy work in Ontario or something like that? So it's almost an essay question, and so there's no answer key per se. The students, we have a rubric which is made up to evaluate the assignments, and the students have to evaluate each of five categories for the assignments and to offer written comments. But the problem is that what I really need to think of, and I have to explore what the software will let me do, is there a way for me to mark the written comments, because some people are doing a fantastic job and then they complain that, you know, the comments they got back were trivial, and so I'm still learning.
Further to the evaluation in terms of how to improve existing courses, what would be your recommended elements that can be introduced to improve the student experience?
You mean like specifically in an online course or like
in regular courses?
Like
that last evaluation suggested that there were elements to improve in regular course, and I was asking in terms of what would be his list of recommendations?
I guess it depends on the course material, but so what I'm thinking of doing, the course that I teach live has a huge lab component. And so I was thinking of making little mini introductory lectures for the labs and then having a quiz at the end of each lecture to ensure that the students show up prepared for the lab. Because right now, to get all the students through the lab exercises you have at the beginning of the course, everybody's taking labs, they have no idea about the course material, and they haven't had it yet, and so it's really brutal to get them done. And so that's the sort of idea I have for that.
Is there a benefit to recording the audio and the presentation using Camtasia or something like that without breaking it into 10-minute chunks?
Can I answer that one?
Yeah.
So the idea of lecture capture versus content that's been specifically designed for online only consumption, lecture capture is more supplemental, right? So you're giving your students, they come to class, but you're giving them the option to review on their own time as needed afterwards. Camtasia is installed on all of the podiums. It would be awesome if you, in my opinion anyways, to provide that resource to your students with clear stipulations about how you expect it to be used and that it doesn't replace class attendance, and bringing up kind of all that, the organizational part of it. So you implement one thing digitally, but it comes with a bunch of supplemental explanations that you might have to spend a little bit of time thinking about and working out the kinks of how you actually choose to implement it in your class. Third row. Yeah, you're sorry. Fourth or third row people.
I have questions for the institutional representative of the university.
Laurie,
and the faculty. Number one is there a strategy emerging how courses will look like in the next 5 years, and how one should position oneself right now to be ready at that time? I mean, regarding the spectrum that you're offering. The second one is about recommendations if one wants to do a certain thing. I mean, like a microphone, what type of microphone one has to buy, what software to use. So just a list of you know, good practices for certain types of course preparations. And the third question that I have is that the kind of institutional support if one wants to do certain things. If I want to upload video, does the university have to upload it to YouTube? Or do I have to use my department's web server? Just these three things.
Maybe I can answer the first one.
Sure.
And then I'll
picture
you. So the institutional strategy is not prescriptive to faculty members of how to design your courses. I see emerging key principles. Susan McCann is our new Vice Provost Innovation and Undergraduate Education, and she's been a year now in this role, and certainly she's particularly attuned to engineering education, which is great. But the kinds of messaging we're hearing from her and from our leadership is more around the idea of flexibility, of thinking about how we can, you know, we have a much wider toolkit now, so choosing which of these tools are most appropriate, and continuing to focus on being learner-centered. So I, in terms of preparing yourself for future, it is very broad, and that's, I guess the strategy is very broad. But if there was something that we would offer you around thinking through, it's more guidance around design process, thinking through linking, you know, we just did a 2-day course design institute, more thinking about how you approach what the student needs to learn and then working backwards from that, from this toolkit, making choices. And every course is different, so we can't give you a cookie cutter, basically.
But what we can give you is a support center. So in engineering, we have an instructional technology office, which is where I work. And what we do is we help every instructor on whatever project they're embarking. So we ask you these key questions about what you're trying to do, and then we help you come up with a plan for making that happen. Some of the stuff we can proactively support. We have a website, which I can share out afterwards as well. It also profiles a lot of our projects. And we have a support site that has almost literally a list of, hey, this is a great microphone for this. This is a great software for this. This is a great tablet for this. This is it's very prescriptive. It's certainly not the be-all and end-all of options that you have. And again, I mean, I would never try to pigeonhole anybody into a certain area, but it's stuff that's worked well for us. It's priced reasonably. We share educational licensing. We have an instructional lab where you're welcome to come in and try Articulate Storyline before you buy it, or try editing a video before you buy it. We have some faculty resources. For example, I have a YouTube channel. I'm happy to I mean, that's a faculty, it's a public resource. I'm happy to manage the upload process for you. We have some institutional resources, such as My Media, which is an archiving for video hosting and media hosting. So there's a lot of support out there. I don't expect any of you guys to know all of that. That's what I do. So what you need to know is that you can email me and that I can help you find out what the answer to your questions are across the spectrum. And I mean, that's one of my selfish reasons for being here today, is so that you can see that there is a faculty support that's just for engineering. So yeah, so we have a website, and maybe I'll send out a package with the PowerPoint presentations, as well as the URL to the, I mean, it's edtech.engineering.utoronto.ca, but you know, we won't test that. And I do have some template. So my other joke about is that engineering really likes to have a prescriptive, logical, practical explanation for things. So I do have some templates that I think are a good base to start from. They need some customization, but they can be helpful depending on your...
And Allison also has a great website with examples of what your colleagues have done. That's exceptional. It's actually been used across the institution, and actually even within the province, it's actually getting some profile. So. Go, Allison.
Yeah. I think we'll go one, two, and then at the back for Serena.
So I've done the, I guess, what you call it, elective online in my course as well, with a tablet. So I used a tablet to present, set up a blackboard a couple years back and record everything. I ran into a little bit of an issue with synchronization. So if students aren't coming to class and they're using the online lectures, it's not necessarily matching up with exactly what I'm doing in class, just because of questions and that sort of thing. So do you have any experience with that, and how did that happen to you, or any sort of suggestions on how you manage that?
I think that's a great question. I think the short answer is I haven't run into that yet, but that's because I've only been posting lectures from that same term. And I certainly know that the students, while they could watch them later, they don't. Because if I'm late a day posting, I'll get, you know, start to get 3-4 emails saying, well, you know, where's the, you know, Tuesday's video? You know, even this summer, we've got a small number of students, but for a day late, they're getting frantic emails over the weekend. So they are watching them, at least that's the sense I get. It'll be really interesting when I do post this high production value set of lecture videos for years to come. I think I'll still, I think there's still value in having the capture from your particular class, because those questions and things, the subtle differences, I think students would still appreciate. So it'll be really interesting to see how people use the pre-prepared lecture videos versus the one from the actual course they're enrolled in. I don't know if I really answered your question. I think that I haven't seen it, I guess, is the short answer. It's a great question, though.
Awesome. Can I just respond quickly? Mm-hmm. So I run our first student design course, you know, and we do just lecture capture, something like this. We record it and post it, and that stems, our purpose for doing that was particularly for our English as a second language students to be able to review, and we stress that coming to lecture is still the primary method. But some years back, I did a study, because I can see when they access these videos, and it's what you'd expect. It was it was opposite what you're saying. They would not look at them until a midterm came up, and then there's this giant spike where everyone who missed an exam would do it, and then it would be quiet again, and then the final came up in a giant spike. And I think that shows that there's a very different usage of those videos. And now keep in mind, ours were just recording hour and 15-minute long videos, meant more as a secondary resource.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I did look at, particularly last term, the view counts, and I was expecting to see that big peak. You could see it was a weekly variation. I think like Wednesday they watched a few more, it went up, and it was cyclic that way, but there wasn't a great big peak right before the exam. There was certainly a 15% lift or something, but it was much more subtle than I expected it to be. They seemed to be really keeping up with the course. There was some... In the online course, because all the material was available, well, I released it every week, it was staged. This one, the only student that seemed to be alive in the course, that's the one that we had the focus group with. He admitted openly that he binge watched them every week, but it was still, so we'd keep up with it, but he would just, you wait for the release of the content for that week, boom, just watch them, and they wouldn't think about the course again until the next release. Which was, he admitted, not a great way to do it. In the end, he did well in the course, but that was maybe a little bit like what you're describing.
I think it might also depend on what is going on in the classroom, depending if you're just delivering content or if there's other activities going on, whether students are coming or not, and the value of just the lecture capture versus attending class versus having additional different online activities.
Is there anything to watch out for when you're transitioning a traditional course into an online environment and still meeting the Canadian Engineering Accreditation Board requirements for that course?
Now there's a skill testing question.
Yeah.
Tom.
Yeah, that's a question that hasn't really been dealt with, I think, at the CEOE level, because we're still in a position of keeping track of hours of instruction. As a starting point. So there are mechanisms for developing an equivalence to some other learning environment that you can describe how you make a transition or a translation from a lecture hour to some other delivery method. But it's still up in the air.
I think one of the design challenges that we have when we move online is sometimes it turns into an overstuffed suitcase with too much stuff in it, and students get a higher workload, which then they're not very happy about at all. So it's both a factor of design thinking about what was the total time I expected a student to spend on this course when it was in class, and thinking what's it reasonable to expect of them when it's moved online, and making sure that we're being reasonable about the time that we expect students. And it shouldn't be more, even if the modality is different, that we aren't overloading our students. And that's part of the design process, is not only equivalency of learning outcomes and equivalency of activities, but just overall not overloading our students. We have a bit of a habit, actually, I would say, of we keep adding technologies onto courses sometimes without taking something else out. And it adds a lot to the curriculum for the students, sometimes overwhelming.
The one thing that we did think about, the course, my online course, the previous in-person version had a practical component, a lab. And so we designed this little box of activities that the students would, well, they were given, and they would buy in the future, because we added it to the ancillary fees list. And so then they'll do those, the online students will perform those at home, and they'll take videos or little pictures and post their solutions or their responses. Is that gonna, I don't know what the accreditation board's gonna think of that, but at least we've tried to match the online, or sorry, the in-person.
I think it's due diligence on the design that you can you feel confident in what you're providing, that it's equivalent.
I think another point to make is not related to the CEAB, but managing the student expectations, because the MIE 515 has been offered since 2002 as a regular lecture course. So when it went online in 2011, the students felt hard done by and protested quite a lot, actually. And so you really have to make it clear that the course is equivalent, all the material is going to be covered, and that there's some access to the prof. That was the main consideration that they were worried about. Well, how am I going to ask the prof questions? So.
Yes.
So I don't think we've heard too much about flipped or inverted classrooms, not as far as I understand what that means. So I wanted to ask the panelists if anyone wanted to share some of their experience with that, particularly in terms of best practices for what kind of activities work well inside the classroom, and also what kind of outside the classroom things they have the students doing beyond just watching a video of a lecture.
Have you either of you done?
I tried it with some of these online resources that I created. It was about a year and a half ago, and maybe my heart wasn't in it. I'm not really convinced, I guess, of the flipped or inverted classroom, and so I had a lot of trouble in a traditional lecture hall going around and making any kind of meaningful use of the time. I had them pre-watch these videos and things, and I did a little survey in class about whether they did or not, I think most of the students did, but I just found that it was not the best use of my time in the class. Now, I personally, my personal sort of philosophy on what I do in the class is I like to, put on a show. It's like, particularly now, I gotta compete for their attention. They've got smartphones, all sorts of things, all competing things, demands on their time, other problem sets they could be working on even while they're sitting in my class. And so I really, really work hard to keep them engaged. And so I think for me, with what I do, that works well in the lecture room, and me trying to walk around and have a meaningful interaction with students doesn't work. And I tried it, it didn't work. To me, that's what the tutorial is really the best at. TAs then, they can work with students in small groups, do the problem solving. I guess the closest I got is last semester I did three review lectures, one before each term test and one before the midterm. I brought up a previous exam and I worked through it and I talked my thought process out to the students through multiple choice. Obviously, this question is wrong, and I tried to teach them little test taking techniques. And I mean, it wasn't a formal study, but the grades were higher than usual. The students responded really well to it. There was no feedback on the course evaluations, whereas it's saying that, there's a discrepancy between lecture and class. In the past, there's been feedback that, we wish there was more time for problems in class. So I did that, and the students seemed to like it. Is that really a flipped classroom? I guess not, but that's my take on it.
I think maybe you're fired as our flipper. Yeah, that's right. Flip classroom.
I never was.
I just flipped my first year design course with a unique student base. It was our T program version. So students who are taking it, they loved it so much the first time they're taking it again. And it was a small, I had 23 students, and so I flipped it entirely. And I thought it went very poorly. My evaluations are the highest I've ever gotten. So some of the things, well, the biggest thing, you were talking about in-lecture activities, the biggest lesson I learned is I have these, I thought flipped campus was going to be great because these are students that struggle, right? I thought, what better students for me to be in, and I'll walk, talk them through this. And at the beginning, I had high hopes. I was just, I didn't really structure the lecture time. I just thought, we're going to just talk about the content, the videos, and all this kind of stuff. Terrible idea. By the end, what I was doing is, for every lecture, I produced this little worksheet, I kind of called it. And depending what the content was, it sometimes would start with, here's some key terms, what are the, define them in your own words, or something like that. And so it was very structured and very applicable to, it wasn't made work stuff, because it was a project-based course as well. So it was all stuff that should help them with that. And once I got to that, and then I would mark these really quickly. I use crowd marks, way the online marking idea back in really quick. And they liked that a lot. So I found that it had to be really structured. And there was other issues I had, like I was using our 15-minute lecture captures instead of actually customized videos, which is a big problem. But the in-class activity was the hardest part for me, to try and figure out what, now I've got this extra time.
What do I do with it? Well, it certainly is a very new thing. And I mean, I think about like what online classes were 10 years ago versus what they are now and what we knew then and what we know now. And it is, I think, something that's going to be happening more and more often. But Scott, like you, when you're talking about lecturing, that's very different than a flipped classroom. Like you're dropping the lecture part. So there's an attachment to a lecture as well. That's an emotional shift as well as a pedagogical shift when you're teaching. And it doesn't mean that everybody has to flip their classroom. Like Scott, you're an extremely charismatic teacher. But if somebody was struggling with that aspect and what worked for them was a guided activity that really met the objectives that they were trying to meet, perhaps it's something that's right for them and not right universally. So there's, what I think is really neat about it is that there are so many more options to achieve the same goal, which is that students are learning in an effective way. And now we have the new building coming with a lot of new rooms. So somebody has to use them, and I'd love to talk to you about it if you're interested, because we have some really good ideas, I think, about how to use those classrooms effectively and how to support a first-time instructor who's teaching in that classroom, how to give them some support while they redefine their entire curriculum, because we should be starting now if you're going to do a flip class when our new building, our beautiful new building, opens.
Yeah, but the problem there would be the number of students that do not fit those rooms.
That's also not
first-year students at our key room holds maximum about 60, and they have the same tutorial half there, half in the classroom. That is not the same. This is going to be a nightmare.
It's clear that the size of sections has to be shifted to fit the rooms available, as opposed to shifting the size of the rooms to fit the number of students that we decide to put in. There's things that need to be done on the other end of the process.
Lori, did you want to give a general ideas of activities
around flip? Well, I would say that the archetypal flipped is to put the lecture video. I mean, that's sort of the origins of it, and some people have done other things with student generated or using textbook materials or other things to prepare. But I think that you zoned in on it is the key is around the needs to be structured, and we need to think about, and then again, traditionally it would be what you were doing individually, you're doing in groups. So typically we see group problem solving or group projects or whatever collaborative building up of understanding of how to solve a problem. There's one interesting, I'll just give an example that's quite interesting that you might have seen. If anyone's seen Melody Newman present, she has a really interesting strategy using, it's almost like scratch cards, so it's team-based, it's almost gamifying solving problems. So they're getting grades and doing multiple attempts. So there's some pieces there that I was just thinking of, if you're looking for concrete examples of what people are doing. And there's also a really excellent website, it's called BlendKit, which I'll provide the URL to Allison. And it's a whole website about blended learning that has different discipline areas and ideas and so on that you might find useful.
I'm writing that down too. At the back.
I was hoping that this is more like a big picture, so I was wondering one of the three types of teaching styles you mentioned are students are more inclined to participate or take the course for? And also, in, you see that in general, you see a shift towards taking online courses in university. And is that necessarily a good thing because we have built all these beautiful buildings? We have some courses that are really more towards emphasizing.
Yeah.
It's basically more about the human interaction, like when we're talking about professionalism or ethics or body language, things like that.
Right.
So how are we going to tackle this?
Okay. The first part around is which modes are best for, was it about which, I've lost track of the first question. I'm just going to go.
So which one of the students, do they prefer blended more? Or
what do they prefer? It really depends on their needs. So I'm going to go back to the theme of flexibility. It could be the timing. It could be the location. It could be the pace. It could be the path. I mean, there are a lot of dimensions of flexibility, and it usually comes back to, for the student benefit, what's a match? So, you know, their motivation is based on needs matching. Mm-hmm. So if it's matching where they're at, either in their, are they a first year undergraduate? You know, they want to be supported. They want to be in the environment. You know, there's an important element there. On the other hand, can we give them an online course the summer before so they have a little bit more time? And they have even maybe more flexibility to make sure they're succeeding. So there's trade-offs there. We see definite growth in professional master's level. I would say that is the big sort of, you know, lifelong learners. You're out in a career and you're trying to take that extra credential to move ahead. And similarly for MOOCs and sort of other types of continuing education, that there's certainly a real demand piece there for the flexibility to accommodate their needs, work-life balance, all kinds of things there. For our undergraduate students, I think a lot of it is around this sort of transformation of teaching and learning. And we would be foolish, I mean, we do have beautiful buildings and we do have amazing experiential learning programs here at U of T that we value, and we know that students come here for those things. But we also know that they have mobile devices in their pockets and they live online and they have there's a whole world they're immersed in. And I don't mean immersive like, you know, Second Life or something. I mean, it's just around them all the time. So I think part of our, what we can give to them as part of their overall undergraduate experience is a range of types of learning, partly online, you know, partly in class, fully online, could be one course in a program of 30 courses, that we're not trying to offshore them. We still want them to be involved in the U of T experience. I'm talking about undergraduates in particular right now. But that we use some of these methods to supplement, to swap out, to offer them choices. Here's, you know, here are the different options that you can choose to take up that help them to navigate that world, because the experience of taking an online course is a useful experience. It's a transferable skill. Can I learn online? Can I be self-directed? Can I self-regulate? Do I have awareness of my own learning style? Do I know what works for me? Those are all valuable things. They're sort of meta skills that come as a bit of a byproduct, really, of learning in online spaces. So that's for me, when I think about how we're going to hold on to the things that we value, and especially in engineering, I know that the experience of being in labs and, you know, contact with faculty and so on is important, but still take advantage of the personalization that can occur by giving them choices that are online. So that's thinking about the learner perspective.
All right.
Does that help? Well, it's partly about use of resources. So we may choose to move some things online to use instructor time better for different things. There's a lot of decision making about best use of both the students' time and instructor's time to optimize their time together.
Yeah. Maybe I can just add a point here and come back to your question about where we should be looking at developing our courses 5 years down the line. I think what we have here is opportunity for personal interaction. So I think what we need to be looking at is what's the most effective use we can make of shared time between instructors and students. And if what you're doing in lecture could be done online, then there's probably something better you can do in your person-to-person time with the students. If for certain courses, certain topics,
demonstration like Scott, yeah.
An excellent lecture may be the best use of your time in contact with the students, and other topics, other subjects, it may be better to spend that time in guided problem solving. So I think what we need to think about going forward is how to most effectively use the advantage that we have as a physical university, which is the personal interaction within the room. And how do we make most effective use of that?
You had a question. You still
want to
ask?
I just had a quick question about how, either any of these methods affected, like lab work or, I guess, tutorials, how that is set up and how that's managed. And then also a question, I know someone mentioned very briefly about peer evaluations, but are there other, I guess, effects of this type of learning on the evaluation method?
Scott, you changed your lab stuff. Do you want to talk about that at all? Like your processes? Yes, I mean, the lab, like I mentioned, we prepared this little kit of activities. It wasn't perfect. I've got a couple of summer students working on improving it for the fall. That's sort of the short answer. The tutorials, I mean, I can elaborate more if you want, but I'm not sure if that's what you're looking for.
I'm asking pretty much how this kind of setup for the lecture affects, like you mentioned, you didn't have a lot to do in lecture, right? When you transferred your videos, you had students access your videos outside of lecture, you didn't have a lot to do in lecture, but I'm saying did it also affect how students engage with lab work? Did it affect how students engage with the tutorials? And did it affect the way you evaluated your students?
So did having the online resources available affect the way that students interacted in the lab, in tutorials, and how I assessed them?
Yeah, pretty much.
So I continue to feel there's value in the lecture, mm-hmm. and I continue to do it. I mean, in the online course, obviously, I didn't have that. So in the online course, where they didn't have the lecture and they only had the online resources, I found the biggest change was in my interaction with them. It was so easy to forget about them. And, you know, I didn't know if they were there. It's kind of like Jim mentioned, just that big population of students that I don't know what they're doing. And then, I mean, unfortunately, there was only four students in my online course. There was an issue with the course being available. And so half the class failed. You know, and I think that they thought that they could do it. It was like Laurie was talking about their own understanding of their best way of learning, and they thought they could do it, and they probably didn't. The other part of your question was how students approached the tutorial in lab. So the tutorial, we had a TA for the course, and there was a tutorial. Well, actually, they were able to talk, to communicate with the TA anytime they wanted to, and they didn't. And I told her, look, email each student personally, and they didn't even respond. So that was bizarre. I don't know why that happened. I had one student who actually came to see me because he was physically on campus, and he saw me in my office. And how they approached the labs, I mean, I think I already talked about that with the little kit. Does that answer your question? Kind of. We can talk later if you like, yeah.
It is 11:27, so for those who need to duck out because they need to be someplace else, please feel free to do so. Are you, as panelists, okay for a couple more?
Yeah.
Because we have a couple hands still.
Allison, just a suggestion. I think it'd be really helpful to instructors if you could offer some sort of the top 10 ed tech resources that you currently see, like on as a regular talk. But just sitting here, I've got to ask you about these quizzes. I've got to ask you about
You can't find. Of course.
Or, all things that people hear about. And you, as you said, it's, EdTech is such a moving target. So even if we check in on you a couple years from now, it'll be a totally different list. So I think it's something that you could offer regularly, like maybe before a semester or something.
Yeah.
Here's where we are. And you could even poll people ahead of time. What are, here are the things that we get asked
for. Sure.
Which are the ones you'd like to
hear
talk about?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. Was there another? Okay, so one, two, three.
So just building on that, I was thinking the same thing. I learned about Piazza and Peer Scholar. How do these things, or what are the best practices, I guess, at integrating them with Blackboard and now Blackboard Collaborate? You know, you can hand in assignments using the journal or the discussion board feature within Blackboard. And, you know, I was using a little bit of it, and I asked the students, and they said, wow, you're really using Blackboard way more than anybody else. And I thought I was barely using it. So what are some best practices to integrate some of these cool things that we've learned about today with Blackboard and Blackboard Collaborate?
So in my opinion, there are a multitude of tools which gives you a really great opportunity to pick the right one for you. The hard thing about that is that there's a multitude of tools. So how do you pick the right one or the one that's right for you? I'd be happy to have a conversation with that. It does go a little bit to education. The hard part with education is that, I mean, we do have a central site that like gives you a brief description about all the tools. Does anybody go to that site and search for things that they don't even know that they're supposed to be searching about? Like, it's a chicken and an egg situation.
How do you know what you're
right? Like, if you don't know what it's out there. I don't think that there's an easy answer to that question other than engaging in the community, talking to me. I'm happy to go through, like, pros and cons. I mean, like there's different reasons why you would use the assignment tool versus the journal tool versus the wiki tool versus Peer Scholar. And talking about what your objectives are would help me identify what a tool would, like, what tool would work best for you. So there's not a one-stop answer.
I would give one, this is my, you know, one, two pieces of advice. First one is call before you dig.
Yeah.
So call Allison first, okay? Yes. Call before you dig. And the second is, if you're using the portal, it's really good as a starting point. It's called a portal. Start here, mm-hmm. and whatever tools you choose, make sure they're linked out of that starting point for the students, and take away everything else that they're not going to use. So that's at least have that kind of for coherence for them. Yeah. Here's my starting point, and here's all the tools I'm going to use as a learner, and let them ignore everything else.
Yeah,
I'd just comment the Peer Scholar works well, perhaps because it was developed at UTSC and they knew about Blackboard. They made it integrated very nicely. The TAs and the students both found it easy to use. Piazza seemed to be slow sometimes to sign people up, but it also worked okay. The beauty about Piazza I tried using discussion boards on Blackboard, but Piazza sends me an email when somebody posts a question and I can respond in 5 minutes. Man, the students love that. Just, it's fantastic. Otherwise, I mean, you gotta log into Blackboard. How many times a day do you log into Blackboard? It's just the pain.
Like 15, 20 times.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. So it dramatically improved my response time by using Piazza. I tried using Blackboard Collaborate. The question previously about the tutorials and stuff, I tried using Blackboard Collaborate for tutorials to be a live presence. And I found that so cumbersome, I couldn't stand it, and the students didn't like it, and so, you know, I went back to a live.
He's fired from our collaboration.
Yeah.
Ambassador. Yes.
We haven't heard much about the opportunity for remedial learning. So sometimes we assume in advanced courses that students have 100% knowledge of prerequisites, which is, of course, a bad assumption. It would be nice to index or have support for finding those aspects of previous courses that students might need to brush up on, that we can point them to in case they find them need, or even they could self-assess through quizzes or something.
Yeah.
I'd be interested to hear about what support there is for that sort of thing.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so this is somebody else asked about, you know, what would I incorporate into my other courses, and this is an area I didn't think to mention, but which I actually intend to do. The live course I teach is a second course in a topic, and so the students have been the course that they need as a prerequisite was taught in second year, and so they're a year away when they teach it, and some of them are 2 years away because of PEY. So I had some live tutorials I used to run reviews that I used to run in tutorials, and I'm going to put them online, and basically they'll go to the course at the very beginning. There'll be some review modules and some quizzes and stuff to get them up to speed. So I think that's a great way for people to implement online technology if you have a prerequisite course to make sure that people are up to speed.
Yeah, I love the idea of the formative quiz, like giving students the autonomy to do that in advance. One of the reasons that we built the EdTech repository was to take the objects that we've spent so much time and effort building out of Portal. Because once you are finished with your Portal shell, you don't have access to all the resources anymore.
Nor do the students, right?
Yeah, yeah. Yes. So the site is, I mean, right now it has a very basic, I mean, it's in progress, so bear with me, but the idea is that it will be indexed. It's indexed by the instructor, by the course that it was originally in. And then if we added a layer like that, there would be a really nice package that students would have access to. But right now, if you took an online course or a module project with the materials developed through my office, those are available publicly online. I promote open access, so we put as much content as possible. And even if we don't put the entire project, we usually have a landing page that's like, hey, this course was developed. This was the instructor. If you're interested in the materials from this course, please contact this instructor.
My intuition is that the granularity is
very overwhelming.
It's very
coarse. Oh.
So what I'd like to have is for the students to be able to zoom in on
So like in response to maybe a question that they got incorrect or something?
Sure. The professor's mentioning some weird topic, a topic that they know they should know, but they don't. And where do they find that remedial learning opportunity?
So, I mean, that's not easy. Any of this isn't easy, but I mean, we do have all of the content that we do have that is designed for online does have specific titles and descriptions and keywords. A lot of it's captioned. Captioning is awesome to make a video searchable. Like one of the things about video is that it's extremely dense. You have a 60-minute lecture, you're not finding anything in that. So there are some things that we can do to make that better. It's an ongoing process. But I think that would be a wonderful use of the stuff that we have.
Learning object repositories are resource intensive to build and maintain.
And we've spent a ton of time building this. And when I look at my analytics, like it's hard to not only build it, it's hard to get people to use it once it's built. So it's a lot of, we're learning. Was there any other questions? Yeah, yes, right, of course.
Can you tell us something about the economics of all of this? So Scott started off by saying you got support to design a course, and I guess this is obvious, like what does the money get spent on? Can you just sort of tell us the really expensive stuff and the really cheap stuff and what's in between, and mention was made of
I think the most
purchasing software, hiring graphic artists, and the flip side of my question is what do you do if you want to be ambitious and you don't have a grant to do this?
The most precious commodity is time, right? Yeah. Time is the most precious thing. So I think most of the funding that we get goes into instructor release. Allison's office production time. I mean, there's hardware too, but
it's not. It's a fraction of the. And we loan things out.
Allison's office, we have to pay for it.
No.
Yes.
So one of the great things is we're cost. I mean, I use the phrase office loosely. It's me and Matthew right now. So we are at your disposal. We don't charge for our services. We schedule projects and we try to stick to our very tight timelines. We do more than just online courses. We do a whole portfolio of things. We also have equipment. So I mentioned that we have a lab with computers with software installed on it. We also have a bunch of equipment that we loan out for a term, for a lecture, for experimentation. I mean, everything from a beautiful, huge Wacom tablet to a Surface Pro to whatever you would, an iPad, I think you should try before you buy, see if the tool works for you. So we do our best to offer you at least a foot in the door without you taking your pocketbook out.
So basically what you're saying, if one wants to be ambitious and use one's own time, then don't worry about the costs if you don't have a grant.
Yeah, so partly you have to take resources into account in designing your course, right? So that if you go with an online course, the course isn't about you. The students want to know that you're there, but like you don't have to be in everything. So one thing we did, for example, was had modular construction of the course. Each module had an introduction with which Matthew filmed for me. Nice, beautiful. The prof is there, right? And then everything else I did at home using Camtasia, basically. And so it's my time.
Lots
of my time.
But then you get to reuse it, right?
That's right. Yeah, Allison provided and Matthew provided editing because I'm a one-take guy. I just blaze through and they have to take out my coughs and all the other
stuff.
Well,
my philosophy is that you do the teaching, we'll do the stuff that we can't do, right? Like, if you dedicate your time, we'll make it as professionally perfect as possible. We can't teach, we can edit. We can support the technology, we can do training guides, we can do introduction, we can do a lot of stuff, but we leave the teaching to you.
And one thing leads to another. If you come to something like this, then you end up meeting up with Allison, and then she says, hey, Lori, I've got this project, you have any funding, and when the next round of grants opportunities come up, we know you're interested, and you've got a little prototype. And so my other advice is one thing leads to another, so just start where you are. Let us, you know, share what you're doing. That's my other advice, because then you find other people who are like-minded or opportunities that might emerge.
Absolutely.
If I just follow up real quick, and then you can jump in. I mean, Allison's office is fantastic, absolutely. But also throw out there, I mean, if you have some questions, and I mean, I'm happy to share my experiences. I'm not saying it's the, you know, the right answer, the best, but I'm happy to, you know, I can show you this. I've got lights and green screen and cameras in my office and stuff, and I've tried different tablets and I've tried different things. Some have worked for me, some have not. I've spent a lot of time learning stuff, post-production and software and things like that, and happy to sit down. I mean, I can save, if you wanted to do something similar to what I've done, I can save you a lot of time. I'm happy to sit down and help anyone with that if you're interested. I'm also happy to answer your question about where I spent the money if you want, but I can.
I also have a short question, if I may. Do you have any thoughts on labeling what you're doing? You tell the students, hey guys, this is a hybrid course. Hmm. Or do you not just do it? Is there any thoughts on that? About
I describe it as how this course works is what you need to communicate to them. Mm-hmm. It doesn't really matter what you call it.
Telling them how up to date you are, how long you are.
I think the labels aren't as important as a really good roadmap at the beginning of the course.
Which is more of a course design principle versus
it's a course design principle.
Design principle. But
what I do is I just tell them, look, I know different people learn differently, so here's resources to help you learn. One thing I learned is if I just put a link on Blackboard, they won't follow it. And it's like Jim said, that we think that they're extremely tech savvy, and they are in, you know, social media and what they need. But Blackboard, it's like they're Luddites. You know, if you got to click more than twice, the students won't find it.
Yeah.
So I'll actually take 10 minutes in class. Not the first week, usually the second week, when they've kind of settled in, especially in September, and I just bring it up. And here's Blackboard. You know, click through. Here's a link to my website, previous exams. Here's a link to my YouTube channel. And then, you know, the number of, is frightening and encouraging at the same time. And
different kind of analytics, Sarah, factor.
So, that helps.
No more questions? Thank you, panelists, for your time.
Thank
especially
the audience
for making yourselves available after the session. I'm sure now that you're all going to be percolating about this, that we'll get some emails. Feel free to stick around for a few minutes if you have a personal question. Otherwise, happy Friday.
Yeah, happy Friday.